Random House Audible presents Eboys by Randall E. Stross. Eboys. The right answer. The guy. No special emphasis on either the or guy, but no intervening pause either. The guy. That's the person needed to head a startup once it has grown beyond a seed. To wit, a stud. Ideally, a big honkin' stud, or a total fuckin' stud. He, or yes, she, will not lack for balls, at least in one sense, but in another will work his nuts off, or his ass off, these being valuable pieces of anatomical real estate. You never hear works his index finger off. A high hustle guy. A total can-do guy. A winner. Smart. Someone with integrity off the charts. Scrappy. A kick-ass dude. A nail-eating, nut-crushing, that trope again, decision-maker. A competitor with killer instincts. Someone who attracts and hires A's, unafraid to hire above himself. A player. A hitter. Finding the guy, finding the right answer, for companies in need, was Dave Byrne's world for 10 years. Thanks to happenstance, Byrne's career as a search guy had begun at the age of 22 in cold call hell. Freshly graduated in 1985 from a small school, Bryant College, with a business degree, he had an appetite for work. During his last 2 years of college, he had taken a full course load, worked at IBM virtually full-time as a marketing assistant, captained the lacrosse team, and led buddies in sundry intramural sports. And in what in the 1980s was defined as the back half of work hard, play hard, the lock and load party, for example, the dorm door was locked, and a concoction of liquor and Kool-Aid that filled a giant garbage can in the room's center was drunk until every person was loaded. He had his coterie of mates, to whom he was fiercely loyal. But outside that circle, he was not a gregarious person. In fact, he was unable to mix without putting many on the defensive. He walked with a chip on his shoulder that he took no pains to disguise. He had a particular aversion to anyone whose status derived from inherited privilege. A college friend would later liken his attitude to that of a ghetto-hardened tough. If it was given to you, don't think you're better than me. His own family had prospered from blue-collar roots, working for General Motors. His grandfather was a union leader who worked 42 years on the assembly line at the Tarrytown, New York plant, and his father, Gus, had followed, directly out of high school, hanging doors on the line. While Dave Byrne was growing up, his father worked the swing shift. But eventually, Gus was able to make the jump to line management. And when Dave was in high school, his father moved into the upper reaches and eventually would oversee 50,000 people at his career's peak before retiring. The ascendance of this high school graduate happened too late for his son Dave to think as ambitiously as he might have about where to take strong grades when applying to college, and too late for Dave to change his own sense of class status. At Bryant, he all but shouted, "Don't think anything was handed to my dad or to me." Graduating from a small school without the national reputation of an Ivy, he was at a disadvantage for entree to the most promising career tracks in business. Resolved to gather the experience and money he would need in order to obtain a Harvard MBA, the instrument that would give him parity, he spoke with anyone he could think of about entry-level positions. He was introduced to Chuck Ramsey, an executive recruiter at sales consultants who worked with technology companies. Ramsey was willing to overlook the fact that the kid did not even know what a recruiter did and give him a try. Hiring Dave Byrne was not an especially expensive risk. The only pay was the commission earned when a candidate was successfully placed, and it was up to the account executive, as Byrne was grandly titled, to obtain the recruiting assignment from an employer willing to pay a contingency fee when hiring a recommended candidate. Byrne was given a phone, a desk, yellow pages, and training that consisted of a simple injunction: have at it. It was not clear why either a prospective client or candidate would take Dave Byrne seriously. He was young and looked even younger than he was. His job experience at that point, summer work on the assembly line and the IBM assistantship as essentially a gopher, had not provided a tour of the upper floors of power. He had no list of successful placements. Why would anyone look at him and sign on? The answer? No one did look at him. The business of placing low and mid-level salespeople was conducted entirely on the phone. What prospective employers and employees heard was a baritone that conferred the authority of someone twice his age. He was a quick study, put in more hours than anyone else, talked his way into assignments, and found recruits. Because debt was anathema to him, he had started with the intention of first saving up enough to pay for business school, and only then applying. But commissions rolled in, almost instantly. After only 6 weeks on the job, the kid had suggested to Ramsey, 21 years his senior, that the two should leave their employer and start their own firm. Ramsey demurred. Byrne did sensationally, and the savings were in place in months, not years. He had simply leaped over the stepping stone of business school to the other shore. A little more than a year later, Byrne finally persuaded Ramsey to join him and start their own search firm, which would exclusively serve clients in high-tech businesses. Late afternoon on day one in their new office in Ossining, New York, with no clients, no candidates, no furniture yet, but a new phone system in place, Byrne got a call from his wife, who informed him, "Market's down 500 points and still going. You couldn't have picked a worse time to do this." It was October 19th, 1987. Perhaps he should have gone to biz school after all, she couldn't suppress saying. "We'll be fine," he reassured her. Then he took immediate action. He purchased a couple of six-packs of Budweiser and sat on the floor with Ramsey, making outlandish predictions about the certain future success of Ramsey Byrne. When narrated by Byrne, the firm's beginning on that forlorn day in October 1987 was the low point, and Ramsey Byrne's conquests, with ever higher profile search assignments, were a string of triumphs comprising an ascending slope. 10 years later, Vanity Fair likened him to Tom Cruise's Jerry Maguire. For the search for Microsoft's chief operating officer, he placed 400 calls, put 79 candidates on his long list, conducted 29 face-to-face interviews, and showed 5 people to Gates, and wrote that he had almost single-handedly turned headhunting into as quasi-glamorous a field as Hollywood agenting. A New York Times piece highlighted Byrne's aggressiveness. "We have no fear," he had declared. "If we could find God's phone number, we'd call him." His 6'6" physical presence enhanced the persona too. A profile in Fortune carried a photograph of Byrne posed like a celebrity for Titleist, in sweater and chinos, standing on a green and leaning on a driver. He was identified above the photo as the headhunter. When it was Byrne himself telling the Ramsey Byrne story, he spun it as a seamless narrative of collective effort, a football team that started on its own goal line, but then scored, scored, scored. What he left out in the telling were the complicating parts that made it interesting, the ways at several junctures he badgered his partners to undertake risks, jeopardizing modest success for the chance to move to the top. He also left out the way he and his colleagues had to project an aura of success for years before it actually existed, the way credit card debt and second mortgages had to tide the business over in the interim, the way the lack of personal contacts within the establishment meant that Ramsey Byrne Associates advanced by dint of brute force will. To begin with, Ramsey and Byrne decided to serve only high-tech businesses and focus on startup companies as their clients. Yet for family reasons, they were determined to set up shop in Ossining, far from Silicon Valley, where most of their prospective clients would be. Erasing that geographic distance meant they would have to be that much better than the competition that enjoyed the benefits of proximity to clients. It also meant that Ramsey Byrne Associates would have to be willing to travel all the time, living in the tube, as Byrne would refer to the weekly or twice-weekly red eyes across the continent. Dave Byrne's pitch to the first prospective client was to ask for one shot, an opportunity to show what his brand of service was like. And once he had the chance, he went maniacal on it. Out-testosteroned everybody, he'd say. The regimen of interviews and travel was self-consciously macho, that is to say, not only heedless of physical well-being, but proudly so. His clients could say of him that he never said no, never deflected a request, never took an easy way out. At one point, he personally had 27 separate searches underway, 27 plates spinning on poles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.